amendments or changes proposed in the way a non-resident would be subjected to tax under the Income Tax Act, and the large part of the budget proposal in this regard is in the context of the changes which are happening globally, with BEPS action plans providing several recommendations to which India is also a significant participant, and MLI being signed by all the countries including India. So as we are aware, in section 9 of the act provides for the source rule for taxation of various incomes in the hands of a non-resident. In section 911, in terms of section 91, clause 1 of section 91, taxation of business income of a non-resident can happen only if the non-resident has a business connection in India. So in order to bring to tax a business income of a non-resident to tax, the first requirement is under the act that there has to be a business connection. Now, business connection in terms of explanation 2 of the income tax of section 91 also include business activities carried on by non-resident through dependent agents. So this dependent agent, business connection through dependent agent, is a concept similar to dependent agency PE under the article 5(5) of the double taxation avoidance treaties. So the language at present is somewhat parametria with the treaty, and the treaty article 5 of the treaty says, so far as dependent agent is concerned, a non-resident who habitually exercise authority to conclude contracts, a person acting on behalf of the non-resident who habitually exercise authority to conclude contract on behalf of a non-resident, that becomes or that constitutes a dependent agent. This terminology or this concept is undergoing a major shift in the proposed amendment, and that I will try to explain. Now, with this provision being there in the Income Tax Act as well as under the treaty, there were many cases where the persons acting on behalf of non-residents used to negotiate contracts on behalf of non-residents, but never used to conclude the contract, and for that reason they were escaping taxation in the source country. To overcome this situation, the BEPS action plan 7 took notice of such avoidance of taxation which were happening by way of commissionary arrangement or fragmentation of business activities, etc. And BEPS action plan, one of the recommendation of BEPS action plan 7 was that an agent would include not only person who habitually conclude contracts on behalf of the non-resident, but also person who habitually plays a principal role leading to the conclusion of the contract. So there is a shift happening from habitually concluding the contract to a person habitually plays a principal role leading to the contract. This is a wider terminology, having wider scope or connotation. So this was the proposal under BEPS action plan 7, and then the BEPS action plan 7 was also included in Article 12 of the Multilateral Convention of Implementation of Treaty Related Measures, which is commonly known as MLIs, which are signed by all several countries including India. So with signing of the MLIs, respective treaties of the countries whosoever are signing the treaties, their respective treaties would get amended to incorporate these recommendations of the BEPS action plan 7. So with this happening, so what would happen is the income tax position, so far as the agent's business connection on account of agency PE or dependent agent is concerned, that would be narrower in comparison to what is the position, what would be the position under the treaty after post MLI being implemented. So naturally, in terms of Section 90, subsection 2, the taxpayer would have option to follow to be governed by the provisions of the Act or the treaty, whichever is more beneficial. So the people would have recourse to the provisions under the Income Tax Act, and therefore this amendment, which has been, or BEPS recommendation, which is put in place through MLI, would not be actually taking effect. So Finance Bill 2008 has proposed to expand the scope of business connection as defined in Section 911, and to introduce the concept of agent habitually playing principal role leading to the conclusion of contract. So in place of habitually concluding contract, the agent habitually playing principal role leading to the contract would come into the statute. And that is how this explanation 2 to Section 9 would look like. So subclause A of explanation 2 to Section 9.1, earlier it says habitually exercises in India authority to conclude contracts. So this language was perimeteria with the treaty. This is going to be struck off, or it is going to be removed, and it's and in place of this, there would be person has habitually exercises in India an authority to conclude contract on behalf of the non-resident, or habitually concludes contract, or habitually plays the principal role leading to conclusion of the contract would come into being. And it further, the amendment further provides that the such contract should be in the name of the non-resident, and they should be for transfer of ownership or granting right to use, etc., and for provision of service to the non-resident. So these three criteria are also provided, and this is consistent with the recommendation of BEPS Action Plan 7. Now, with this change, provisions of business connection under Section 9 would get aligned with the provisions under the treaty post MLI situation. Now, what would be the effect of this on the day-to-day transactions which are happening? For instance, if the agent here identifies business opportunity for non-resident principal, while the final negotiation is undertaken by the non-resident, whether it will constitute a business connection on account of there being a dependent agency. To my mind, and going by the and with the experience, one can say that the assessing officer is likely to say in all such cases, for instance, acting as a communication channel and responding to the queries, participation in negotiations of negotiation while principal is signing the agreement, providing quotations and clarifications. These are open issues. There would be these kind of situation would have to be revisited and tested before the court. But going by the experience, in all such cases also, the assessing officer is going to be to say that there is a business connection which exists. So what I am trying to say is that this terminology, playing the principal role leading to the conclusion of the contract, itself wide enough, and also it has certain element of subjectivity, and the assessing officer would have a larger canvas of ground to cover more and more transactions, to bring in the scope of business connection, so as to bring to tax the non-residents, commissioners or agents who are undertaking such activities in India.
But see, till the time the treaty provisions are more beneficial.
Yeah.
Does the same continue to take the benefit?
Till the time MLI actually does get in, is comes into force, MLIs have now to be ratified by at least 5 signatories countries in their local laws. That has to happen, and prior to that, till such time, that happens, treaty provisions as it exists, that would govern, and if it is beneficial, that would have to be followed.
What is the broad time period?
I think post 2000, it should take 1 to 2 years after 2019. That is what the reports are. Then second significant change in section 9 that is being proposed is introducing the concept of significant economic presence. Now, and this concept is again coming through the BEPS recommendation, and it is an advent or consequence of the digital economy. These transactions, so BEPS action plan recommended that in order to modification of the definition of the PE to take care of these newer economies, digital economies, challenges on account of these newer economies, by proposing change in the definition of the PE by bringing in significant economic presence in another country or significant digital presence in the other country. And the second recommendation was that the virtual PE could be constituted if the website of a taxpayer is maintained on the in other jurisdiction and on the server of the other jurisdiction, and through that server the transactions or business is carried on through the website. So that would also constitute a virtual PE. At present that does not constitute PE. In light of these recommendation, there were three remedies which OECD BEPS report provided, that there should be a new nexus rule based on concept of significant economic presence. That was the first recommendation. Then it recommended withholding tax on certain type of digital transactions and an equalization levy. Equalization levy was introduced by the Finance Act 2016. Now government with this budget in 2018 is introducing this second remedy which was recommended by BEPS Section Plan 1. Related to the new nexus rule based on significant economic presence. Now, just to give a brief background of the current position under the Act, Section 9(1) generally talks about business connection on the basis of physical presence based nexus rule. Now, Supreme Court even coined in case of Ishikawajima and Hyundai heavy industries, etc., the concept of territorial nexus. So what is required to constitute what at present is required to constitute a business connection is a physical presence or a territorial nexus. So this definition of under the section or the requirement under clause 1 of subsection 1 of section 9 does not take care of these transactions in the digitized world, which does not require a physical presence, and or it does not even require an agent to undertake a transaction, and the transactions can be undertaken from offshore without there being a physical presence or an agent being there on the soil of the other country. So these transaction or these businesses which are these days growing by leaps and bounds, they are escaping taxation, they are not subjected to taxation in the source country, and the source country is for that reason losing the tax which it is legitimately it should be entitled to. So address this, now let's understand what the significant to address this, the finance bill has also to bring its Income Tax Act in line with the OECD position. It seeks to introduce explanation 2A to clause 1 of subsection 1 of section 9 to introduce this concept of significant economic presence. So it provides that a significant economic presence for the purpose shall mean any transaction in respect of goods, services or property carried on, and I am just reading this these provisions verbatim because this is what the law is going to be going forward. The transaction in respect of any goods, services or property carried out by the non-resident in India, including provision of downloading data or software in India, if that would be that would constitute business connection, if the aggregate of the payment arising from such transaction or transactions. So it is taking care of the issue related to fragmentation, which I will explain a little later. during the previous year exceed the amount as may be prescribed. So, for such transaction, if such transactions payment in respect of such transaction exceeds certain threshold which may be prescribed, then there would be it would constitute a big business connection, and these transaction would be then these payment would be subject to taxes. That is one aspect of one limb of this significant economic presence. The second limb of this concept is that systematic and continuous soliciting of business activities or interaction with the with such number of users again would have to be prescribed in India through digital means. So Amazon or Google of the world, if they are transacting here, interacting with users, then and their customer base in exceeds certain number or threshold which may be prescribed, they would constitute a business connection, and their income from India would naturally then get subjected to tax. This is what the import of this significant economic presence, which is going concept of significant economic concept presence, which is going to be introduced in the in section 9(1). So, and at present, all these companies otherwise escaping taxation in India for the reason that they don't constitute a PE, and of course they would constitute they would continue to claim benefit of the treaty position unless and until the MLIs come into force and treaty definition is also correspondingly amended. So that is what the finance bill proposes so far as this aspect of the matter is concerned. And one more thing, actually, we are aware that there is correspondingly there is an equalization levy which is to be paid at the rate of 6% on online advertising payments to foreign entities. So on one hand there is a business connection, and on the other hand for advertisement payments there is an equalization levy. Now what comes to my mind is that an equalization levy is not levied if non-resident is found to have a permanent establishment in India, then equalization levy is not required to be paid. So if in the post MLI situation, either the same transaction can be can constitute a business connection because of the significant presence in the in section 9(1), or it can it can result in a permanent establishment under the treaty. If it is characterized, or the taxpayer opts that it is to be characterized as a permanent establishment under in terms of the treaty, then possibly equalization levy, the charge of equalization levy would not be there in the post MLI situation. Accordingly, and I said, these threshold for revenue and users would be are yet to be prescribed for giving effect to this, and this concept of significant economic presence has already been implemented by Israel, Italy, Kuwait, and Saudi Arabia.
If we just stop here for a moment, let's illustrate this point, this significant economic presence. Many of you and most of you may have this downloaded the Uber app. We'll just give an example to illustrate this point. Now, when you press the app, you get to know the location of the driver, and the driver comes, you get into the vehicle, and the driver drives you to your destination, drops you at a particular point, and ultimately the fare is paid either through Paytm or whichever means you adopt. Now, the server is owned by Uber Inc., which is sitting somewhere in the US or wherever outside of India. There is a company in India which is a subsidiary or an independent agency of Uber India, and there is the driver and there is the passenger. Now, the question that arises is that when you hail the cab and when you actually sit in the cab, is there a contract between you and Uber Inc. or you and Uber India or between you and the driver? I would personally take the view that legally there is a contract between you and the driver, because the driver is driving you. The driver is not employed by Uber. In fact, that's the model that is followed by Uber worldwide, that the driver is not employed by Uber. So if there is any mishap that happens, Uber disclaims any responsibility. Although in the UK, the court has held, and it was in the context of a case taken by the driver who was, you know, fired by Uber. So in that context, the UK court said that the driver is actually an employee of Uber, but we leave that apart from the timing. So legally, if there is a contract between you and the driver, there is no income that will accrue to Uber from that payment. Uber ultimately realizes a small portion for facilitating this contract between the passenger and the driver who owns the vehicle or is driving on behalf of somebody else. So in this scenario, right now, the position being taken was that Uber Inc. is not liable to tax in India because they don't have a PE in India. This is not fees for technical services. This is not royalty. Somebody is using their app to avail a taxi service. So with this significant economic presence, what is being pointed out, that it may be difficult for companies like Uber to escape taxation in India when it talks of that there is a service PE, a virtual PE. It may also be a systematic and continuous soliciting of business activities or engaging in interaction with such number of users as may be prescribed through digital means.
It can serve.
So this is casting the net very wide.
Very wide. Even it will fall in the first limb itself, wherein it says that transaction in respect of any goods or service.
Yes.
So it is, there is a transaction of service. This Uber is rendering a service.
So therefore, this whether it is intended to get into the tax net these kind of service providers who are basically aggregators or facilitators.
So even downloading of software, downloading of data, which was hitherto not taxable neither as business income nor as royalty, even downloading of data was held to be not in the nature of royalty, that we get taxed here.
And I think this problem is not peculiar to India. In fact, all the countries in the world are grappling with how to tax the appropriate share of revenue from all these service providers. So the BEPS action plan has got all countries together, and the countries have come to almost a unanimous consensus of how to move forward in this direction.
But in this case, the driver is not giving the invoice to the passenger. Uber is giving the invoice. So the transaction between is between Uber and the passenger.
No, I don't know. So the invoice is given by the Indian company. If you see, the US company is not giving any invoice. The first point was that the Uber Inc., which is actually facilitating everything through its virtual presence, once you download the app of Uber Inc., you are actually able to go through the entire transaction. The app actually connects you to the driver comes, he picks you up, you pay to the driver or you pay through Paytm. The money actually goes to an Indian company, which facilitates everything. And then they either reimburse it to the driver and the balance, that may be a small portion, which may ultimately be going to the outside India.
You see, the service is being availed by the customer who is sitting in the car, or service is being availed from Uber by the driver or the company who is running these taxis here in India. In all the three situations, the rigors of significance presence or the business connection would come into play. Who is receiving service is not material. Whether the service is coming directly to the customer or it is coming to the taxi driver from Uber, and taxi driver in turn is paying to Uber. In either situation there would be a taxation of this income, this payment which is going to Uber.
Yes, that is taxed.
If it goes to Uber India, then it cannot go to Uber Inc. It will be double taxation.
So what happens is, the model which they normally follow is, there is an Uber Inc. and their server is also outside India. What you do is, you only connect with their server, download the app in your phone or whatever system, which is free. So they don't charge you for the downloading of that software. Thereafter, that connects you with the driver. So either you make payment to the driver, or you make payment through Paytm, etc., and there is an Indian company which is there, which is paying appropriate taxes on the income which it earns.
Which is only a collecting.
So where is the income of Uber Inc.?
So for example, if you pay 100 rupees for availing that services, 90 may be going to the driver, 5 may be retained by the Indian company, and 5 may be going to the Uber Inc.
Through the Indian company?
Through that Indian company. So that is technically not technical, may not be technical services. Technically, that may not be royalty, and in the absence of the physical presence of Uber Inc. in India, that also does not constitute a PE in India. And so therefore that 5 rupees was getting untaxed.
And it would be going under any other GAB.
Correct.
And as facilitation fee or whatever, but technically not a technical services.
And today is narrow to say that you must be allowed use of the copyright in the software in order that it can be royalty.
And
so here if you are only downloading the software, this is not really used. You can't tamper or play with the software. So in that case, it may not be royalty today. So Uber Inc's payment is not being subjected to tax in India. In fact, there is a live example of an Indian company having a block arrangement with Uber, saying that we will hire so many vehicles or we will make available on demand so many vehicles. Now the question the tax department has raised is whether 194C will apply. So 194C will apply if it is a contract for carriage of passengers. Now the contract for carriage of passengers is with the driver, not with Uber India or Uber Inc. So legally, I think all these things will come or not.
And if we see the language of the section itself, there are two triggers or two aspects. One, there is a trigger in a sense that there should be a transaction of service by the non-resident. Then any payment arising there from such transaction, the payment can take any mode, any form. The payment can be made through the company here. If there is a payment happening, then the rigors of these provisions are attracted. If there is no payment, there is no taxation.
And I think the proviso, the proposed proviso also makes it clear that if you have a significant economic presence in India, whether or not the non-resident has a place of business in India or renders service in India. Now, Uber Inc may claim they are rendering services overseas when you access the server. But the significant economic presence will rope in such kind of cases as well.
So, with this amendment, all such companies.
There is another. One more example, not through digital one. Suppose an Indian entity is providing a service to a foreign entity. An Indian entity is providing a service to a foreign entity and getting the charges reimbursed to him with a markup and paying full tax. But the service is like doing a negotiation, facilitating a negotiation between the foreign entity and a third party in India. So basically, he's participating into the negotiation. Now, in spite of this Indian entity getting the service charges and paying tax, the foreign entity will be held to be a PE, has a PE in India because he's facilitating the contract. And he has to pay tax on the profits attributable to the PE functions.
You see, constituting a PE, and what would then the income that would be attributed to the PE, these are two different aspects. The first, once the PE is constituted because of this activity, then the question of attribution arises. If whatever charges that have been paid to the Indian company who is acting as an agent, and that therefore it becomes a PE, if that is good enough and found to be at arm's length, and no further attribution is necessary for the that could be attributed to the PE, then there cannot be any further taxation of the income in that. And now, the last link to these amendments, I'll just take you back to the definition of significant economic presence which is provided. You see, if we see the second bullet in the definition, it says the aggregate of payment arising from such transaction or transactions during the previous year. So these words, aggregate of payment arising from such transaction or transactions are significant. This is what is the anti-fragmentation law which is sought to be incorporated under the statute.
Earlier, and it has been norm in EPC contracts and several such contracts to split the contract of one composite cohesive contract into several smaller contracts, so as to escape taxation. on at least some of the some of such contracts. Now, for the purpose of this, because of this amendment, for constituting a business connection, a significant economic presence would be seen taking all the all such contracts or such transactions together. An aggregate payment, if it exceeds the threshold, that would result in a business connection getting created, and this is what is called anti-fragmentation rule, which is sought to be provided in the statute. Now, we have given several examples, but we have also discussed these examples in the course of the discussion, so I'll rather skip these examples. Now, coming to the transfer pricing amendments, and I'll just keep it very short in the interest of time. CBCR reporting requirement was introduced by the Finance Act 2016. By inserting section 286. Now, this report in form 3CEAD was required to be furnished by the due date of filing of return, that was 30th November, and this due date for the financial year 2016-17 recently was extended by the CBDT by issuing a circular to 31st March 2018 to facilitate the taxpayer for with the filing of the CBCR. OECD in web section plan 13, when it recommended CBCR, it recommended 1 year's interregnum from the close of the financial year for filing the CBCR report, because what was felt is that there are several documents and data is may be required to be provided. Most of the countries across the globe are accordingly providing 12 months time period for filing of the CBCR report, with only two exceptions. That of US provides for filing of CBCR report by 15th April, and China by 31st May. Their accounting periods end on December, so they in these two countries 4 or 5 months time is given. In line with the OECD recommendation, government now has extended the due date for filing CBCR report to 31st March in the statute itself. So, this due date now stands extended. Then another small amendment which is proposed is when CBCR is not being filed by the overseas parent, the Indian company would have to file the CBCR. There were two situations were already captured where the CBCR requirement was not there in the there was no agreement for exchange of CBCR report in the statute with that country, then Indian company was required to file. And when there is a systematic failure of the non-resident or the parent country to provide CBCR report, then Indian company was obliged to file the CBCR instead of the parent company. Now, the third situation which was remaining was where the local statute of the parent company does not provide for filing of CBCR itself. In that situation also, Indian company would have to file the CBCR report unless an alternate reporting entity has already filed the CBCR. So, this is the import of the amendment so far as CBCR and transfer pricing is concerned. No, master file and CBCR are separate requirements.
Okay.
So, master file is to be filed by one entity.
Okay.
And all other subsidiary entity has to inform the tax officer by way of a form that which entity would be filing the master file.
Okay.
So, they are...
This due date has already gone. It was 31st January.
Yes, yes. All the companies have reported. There was a form to be filed. So, if there are more than one subsidiary company, they have to be intimating. No, that due date was for the CBCR report.
Okay.
Which country or which entity in which jurisdiction CBCR report would be filed.
What about P, either project P or service P? whether they are required to file or
You see, CBCR is required to file to be filed by the companies whose accounts are getting consolidated, who are part of the multinational group. CBCR is required to be filed by the head office. So if there is a permanent establishment here, the permanent establishment by definition being a branch, not the head office or the parent, it is not required to file a CBCR. CBCR would be filed by the head office or the parent. Then, do I continue? I think we can straight away come to the capital gain related amendments. Would you like to take on?
Moving on to the next major amendment, which is basically the amendment relating to the taxation of capital gains. So this page number of the slide is, this is page number 82. What? So these are actually 2:1, there is two pages on one slide. So the major amendment which has actually taken place is in section 1038. The presently, the entire long-term capital gains, which are subjected to sale on a recognized stock exchange and on which you pay STT, they are exempt from tax under section 1038. The proposal, under the finance bill, the proposal is that insofar as the transaction which takes, long-term capital gains transaction which takes place on the recognized stock exchange and on which you pay STT, they will be subjected to the tax at a concession rate of 10%. Now, a very important amendment or the computation aspect which has been provided is the grandfathering of the cost as on 31st January 2018. So, how it will work is simply is that whatever is the fair market value of the shares as prevailing on recognized stock exchange as on 31st January 2018 or the cost of acquisition, whichever is higher, that will be regarded as your cost of acquisition for the purpose of computing your capital gains. But and the difference between the sale consideration and the grandfathered cost, which is the cost as on 31st January 2018, will be your capital gains. We have just tried to explain it with the help of simple example, must be around 43 slide number. Now we have given three examples over here. So for example, in first example, the cost of acquisition of the shares in the hands of the assessee is 100 rupees. The fair market value of the shares as on 31st January 2018, which is the grandfathered cost, is 120 rupees and the sale consideration is 130 rupees. Now, in this situation, the taxable capital gains would be 10 rupees only, which is sale consideration 130 rupees minus 120, which is the fair market value as on 31st January 2018. Now, over and above the total capital gains of 1 lakh rupees. So, if during the relevant year, your capital gain is 90,000 after following this formula, there is no taxation. Any long term capital gains over 1 lakh rupees after following this formula will be subjected to tax at the concessional rate of 10%. In the second example, what we have said is, supposedly the cost of acquisition is 80 rupees, the fair market value is 100 rupees. But your sale consideration is 90 rupees. In this case, the LTCG will be zero. You won't get a benefit of 10 rupees of loss because that is the fair market value of 100 rupees. But since your sale consideration is 90 rupees, the lower of the two has to be taken. So 90 rupees will be taken and 90 rupees will be this capital gains, there will be no capital gains and the capital gains would be zero. In this third situation, we have taken the cost of acquisition as 120 rupees. The fair market value as on 31st January 2018 is 80 rupees and your sale consideration is 150 rupees. Now you have to take the higher of the two. So fair market value as on 31st January 2018 was 80 rupees. Cost of acquisition is 120 rupees. So higher of the two is 120 rupees and your sale consideration is 150 rupees. So the difference between the two, which is 30 rupees, now this 30 rupees will be subjected to tax at the concession rate of 10%. So this is how the capital gains will be subjected to tax. And considering the fact that the markets were at all time high as on 31st January 2018, so what we foresee is that the chances of the capital gains arising in the hands of individuals is less unless the market shoots up beyond the price prevailing as on 31st January 2018. That is first aspect. The second aspect is the capital gains up to 1 lakh rupees is exempt. So up to 1 lakh there is no taxation of long term capital gains. So any gain over and above 1 lakh will be subjected to tax at concession rate of 10%.
Can't be adjustment of loss of second equity against gain of first equity.
No, this is not what we are saying. Sir, this is individual examples we have given for computing the capital gains. Supposingly, after determining your capital gains, there is a gain in one, there is a loss in one. So you can obviously set off the two. So
against the equity we can set, but you are saying there is no carry forward of the loss against.
No, in second example, sir, it was notional. If you see the second example, probably you are referring to second example. Yeah. In the second example, the loss is arising because of the adoption of 100 rupees as the grandfather cost.
Yes.
That was not your actual loss. Your actual loss would be allowed. Supposingly, you sell at 100 rupees, your actual cost is 120 rupees.
So, in this second case, if I sell at 70 rupees.
In that situation, 10 rupees will be your loss.
So, that can be carried over?
That can be carried over. In fact, that is one of our comments. Under the present regime, there is always a dispute whether or not the long-term capital loss arising on transfer of shares on recognized stock exchange, they are admissible or not. One view is they are not admissible because the gains are exempt from tax. The other view is, in fact, that has been held in some of the judicial precedents also, because the source of income is not exempt. The shares per se is not exempt from tax, the loss would be admissible. But that's a highly debatable issue. But since under the new regime, since now the long-term capital gains would be subjected to tax, though at a concessional rate, even the loss which you have suffered on any long-term capital gains, that will be allowed to you and that will be subjected to adjustment in accordance with the provisions of the Act.
Okay, that's one point. Secondly, suppose somebody sells this by 31st March, then 31st January is not relevant at all.
Correct. In fact, we are coming to that. Okay. This amendment applies only to transfers which are taking place after 31st March 2018. So therefore, this amendment applies from assessment at 2019-20 onwards. This is not applicable to transfer taking place as on till 31st March 2018. So a simple tax planning could be, you transfer the shares till 31st March 2018 and repurchase the shares at the new value till 31st March 2018. So you get a new cost going forward when you are subsequently going to transfer the shares. But that may not be practically feasible in case you are holding large large quantities. But if you are holding small quantities of shares, then obviously you can transfer it, book the gain or loss. In fact, the most likely there is not going to be a gain because the markets have come down after the budget. But in case there is small gain or small loss, you can book that loss and subsequently your cost will get reinstated to the fair market value at which you acquire the shares. And this is what we have explained. The entire provisions have been explained over here. So it says that LTCG would be computed as per 48 under the new regime. For the purpose of computing the LTCG, the fair market value as on first LTCG arising from investments made before 1st February 2018 have been grandfathered as much as cost of acquisition thereof shall be deemed to be higher of the following, which is actual cost of acquisition, or lower of the following, which is the fair market value or full value of consideration which you receive. Which is the second example, because in the second example, you actually received 90 rupees, the grandfathered cost was 100 rupees, so therefore your cost was lower of the two, which is 90 rupees, and therefore there was no actual loss in that situation, and the capital gains would be nil. And for the purpose of determining the grandfathered cost, the law provides that you will take the highest price which is available on the shares quoted on the stock exchange as on 31st January 2018, and in case shares are not frequently traded and were not traded on that date, then you have to take the fair market value on the date immediately preceding the dates as and when these shares were traded.
Sir, who will deduct TDS on long-term capital gain?
But that is only applicable in case the transferor is the foreign party.
No, no. In
memorandum, page number second.
No, law, under in the section, it, there is no, it's not provided. In the fine print.
Sir, in memorandum, page number second.
No, memorandum may have said this, but I didn't see it in the section per se. No, this is the taxability. 112 is taxation of long-term capital gains, which is providing for 20% rate. 112A, which is the proposed new amendment, that is provide for the levy of charge. That's a chargeability section, where you provide the percentage at which it is taxable. That's not a TDS provision.
TDS.
We'll check it. According to me, I don't didn't see anything in the with regard to TDS in the section itself. Because on capital gains, you don't deduct TDS generally. So these are some of our comments. The beneficial rate is available only if STT was paid. That was the situation. And you can now, that's the last bullet which you have pointed out, loss on transfer of listed securities would now be clearly available to you for set off in accordance with the provisions of chapter 6.
Rohit, one question to you. This 1 lakh is not a standard deduction. I think this 1 lakh will be available only qua these shares.
This is not standard deduction. Any capital gains over and above rupees 1 lakh.
No, capital gains qua shares only.
Qua shares?
Qua shares only.
Which are subjected to tax under section 112A.
Equity mutual fund is also included.
Yes. Equity oriented fund. No, only 10,000 rupees will be taxed at 10%.
I need it.
It says any capital gains above 1 lakh rupees. Now, this was the first major amendment. The second amendment is with regard to IFC. Some question.
Rohit, I have a question on this capital gains like FI. 112A does not apply to FI. FI is governed by 115AD.
Correct.
So this cost grandfather has happened to FIs also?
Yeah, that clarification has come. This,
I think there yesterday evening there was a clarification which was reported that clarification has come.
But in the fine print it's not there.
Fine print, I don't think. We can check up, we'll forward that clarification also.
Okay. Thank you.
So does the asset has to be a long-term capital asset as on 31st January 2018?
No, it is not provided. At the time of sale, this should be long-term capital asset.
Yeah, so if I acquired it in April last year, as on 31st January, it is not yet a long-term
capital asset. No, so if you transfer, it will be subjected to tax at this concession rate of 15% under that different section 111A or something.
No, if I sell it in May, let's say in
then April, it becomes long-term. Then yeah, it so becomes long term.
Can I take their benefit of grandfathering?
As per the fine print, as per technically, yes, you can take the benefit of grandfathering because once you transfer it, it is a long term capital asset.
Yeah.
And the cost as on 31st January 2018 will have to be adopted.
Okay.
Your point is that as on 31st January 2018, it was not a long term asset.
Yes, exactly.
But at the time of sale,
yes.
By that, because of the passage of time, it becomes a long term asset. And therefore, whether the benefit is available or not,
yeah.
Technically speaking, yes, it will be available because at the time of sale, it will be long-term capital gains and section 112A, which is the proposed amendment, would apply.
Okay, thank you.
We'll check it because in the section, it's not there.
100?
Of memorandum or of the bill? Tax pen. Tax memo. But we'll check it and this clarify this aspect.
What about the original allotment of shares? That is, if at the time of STT paid, then only it will be applicable.
Actually, there is a clarification. If you see in the context of the existing law also, the law has been amended that the STT should be paid both at the time of acquisition and both at the time of sale. Unless otherwise prescribed by the notification. Subsequently, the notification came in and only specific categories of shares were excluded. So, for example, if you receive the shares at the time of original allotment or at the time of gift, when you don't pay the STT, they are still eligible for that exemption. There is a specific notification under the existing law. And they say, and they are still to notify under the, this law. So we feel that the same notification would be notified for this purpose also. This would be, because you will have to, that the normal mechanism remains the same. 100 and, but they have only, the, what the finance bill proposes is to amend section 1038 and bringing in a new section for the purpose of levy of tax. The rest of the machinery for the computation of capital gains remains the same. Benefit of indexation is not granted because this is subjected to concessional rate of tax at the rate of 10%. And you are grand, because you are actually, once the cost itself is grandfathered, the concept of indexation is bringing the cost to the current level. So once the cost itself is grandfathered as on 31st January 2018, there is an inherent concept of indexation already applied. Correct. That will be the actual cost then. Whatever. Okay.
How can you?
But bonus shares, at this of section 49, it is deemed to be nil.
This grandfathering of the cost is in respect of long-term capital asset acquired by the assessee before 1st February 2018. So when your bonus shares are allotted in March 2018, you can't give the benefit of the grandfathering. So that asset must exist. So the bonus shares were not in existence on that date. I think Ravi, yes.
The cost of acquisition is 100 and they are sold after 1 year after the long term period is over for about 200. Then the capital gain is straight 200 minus 100
at
because there is no indexation also.
Yes.
So and no grandfathering will apply.
No grandfathering will apply.
Okay.
But then in that situation we can take the benefit of that other section.
1038 chala jayega.
हाँ, but 10% वाला देश का concession rate
112 वाला,
but there is another section for in so far as listed securities are concerned, without the benefit of indexation you can pay tax at the rate of 10%.
ये भी तो 10 ही है?
नहीं, यहाँ तो मिलेगा नहीं, without indexation.
आप 112 में तो without indexation 10 है.
So it will be 10%, yes, 10% would be the amount which would be payable. So moving ahead, the next amendment is with regard to IFSC, which has basically set up under the SEZ Act. Now, one of the IFSC has been set up in Gujarat. Now, in order to encourage the transaction on IFSC, International Financial Services Center, the finance bill proposes to amend the law to provide that any transactions by a non-resident on an IFSC would be exempt from tax, provided the transactions are of the nature of transactions of bond and GDRs, rupee denominated bonds of Indian company, derivatives, and the consideration is exchanged within the foreign currency. So this is another amendment. And the second amendment is that the alternate minimum tax, which is applicable to an IFC, which is similar to the partnership firm, that has been, the rate has been reduced from 18.5% to 9%. The next amendment is with regard to 54EC. Now, if you transfer a capital asset, which is subjected to long-term capital gains, in order to mitigate or reduce your tax incidence, you can invest in certain certain notified bonds, which are for under the existing provision, they are for a period of 3 years. And once the capital gain is invested in those bonds, up to a investment of 50 lakhs of rupees, you get a exemption under section 54EC. The two amendments which are proposed in 54ECs, one is that the new bonds are to come, which are to be invested after 1st April 2018, which are redeemable after 5 years. So the period is proposed to be extended from 3 years to 5 years for the new bonds. And the second major amendment in 54EC is that this benefit would be admissible
only for transactions of capital gains arising on transfer of land and building. So presently, any capital gains arising on transfer of any long-term capital asset, you can claim the benefit of exemption under 54EC by investing the capital gains. But going forward, this exemption would be admissible only with reference to long-term capital gains on arising on transfer of land and building. Now, coming to another major amendment, which is with regard to deemed dividends. Now, as everyone is aware that there is a specific provision, section 222, which talks of deemed dividend. So there are five instances of where you actually do not pay the dividend, but there is a distribution of assets by the company, or there may be a loan given by a company to its major, to a shareholder holding more than 10% of the voting right. In that situation, it is treated as deemed dividend. And now the amendment which is proposed is that, and ultimately the taxability of deemed dividend is restricted to the accumulated reserves. Sometimes what the companies were doing was, supposedly the company has accumulated revenue reserves, and if that company were to pay the dividend, that would have become deemed dividend under section 222. Now the tax planning which was being done was that amalgamating that company was merged with another company which was probably having the losses. As a consequence of amalgamation of that amalgamating company having accumulated reserves with a new company having losses, the revenue reserves were wiped out, and thereafter if you were to distribute the assets to the shareholder under 222D or 220, or you were to give the loan, that were not subjected to dividend deemed dividend. We have explained it with the help of two illustrations. The first illustration, if you will see, is an amalgamating company having an equity share capital of 1000 rupees and the reserves of 9000 rupees. So assuming for a moment that this 9000 rupees is revenue reserves, and if this company has an assets of 10500 rupees and including the cash which is part of 2500 rupees. Now if this amalgamating company were to undertake a transactions of reduction of capital or were to distribute the assets, then to the extent of 9000 rupees, that would be regarded as deemed dividend. Now what the companies were doing was, this company was merged in another company which was having a negative revenue reserves of 10,000. So there was a loss of 10,000 rupees. So when you do a line to line merger, the balance sheet of the consolidated entity would be on the extreme right, which would have a reserves of minus reserves of 1,000. And if the amalgamated company were to distribute the assets in the absence of revenue reserves in this company, it was not subjected to tax as deemed dividend. So therefore, the finance bill proposes to amend the law to provide that in case of amalgamated entity, the reserves of the revenue reserves of the amalgamated entity would be increased by the profits of the amalgamating entity. So in this example, in first example, what will happen is minus 1000 would be increased by 9000, which was the revenue reserves of the amalgamating entity, and therefore it would become 8000 positive. And therefore, when the amalgamated entity, even if it were to undertake a transaction of distribution of assets to the extent of 8000, this will be subject to the deemed dividend.
I think this is highly debatable whether you need to add back
that 9000 once again.
I think what Rohit is suggesting is, on a reading of this provision, this loss of 1000, which is the consolidated negative reserves of the amalgamated company, should once again be increased by 9000. So in order that you get a taxable, or you get a positive reserves of 8000, and to that extent you can tax any distribution made by the amalgamated company to its shareholders as deemed dividend under section 222. I would think that the law should not or does not provide for a double addition of this 9000. You already factored in 9000 when you've reduced the reserves of the consolidated company, of the amalgamated company, which have a negative reserve of 10000. But clearly the intent of the legislature seems to be what Rohit is suggesting, in order to rope in these transactions where you amalgamate a cash rich company with positive reserves into a loss making company, distribute the cash out to the shareholders, and ultimately avoid any tax. That seems to be the intent. But having regard to the language, I think
it will be debatable of how this will actually work.
So the fine print actually says that the losses or the gains of the amalgamated entity would be increased by the revenue reserve, positive revenue reserves of the amalgamating entity. So in this situation, minus 1000 would have to be increased by 9000 rupees, and therefore it would be 8000. And as per the fine print, the technical language of the section, to the extent of 8000, this will be subjected to dividend distribution deemed dividend provisions.
So we have to find a company which has doubled the.
Yes.
Sorry.
This would be. These are revenue reserves which are to be considered for the purpose of deemed dividend.
For financial books. Your accumulated profits are seen as per your financial books, not tax books. For 222E, you don't go by assessable profits. You go by the profit in your book.
So double entry would be then like a question mark.
No, this will be a double hit in that sense. Yeah,
in that sense.
In fact, there are connected issues to this, because it says you have to take this position as on the date of amalgamation. Now, when they say as on the date of amalgamation, two questions arise. One, the date of amalgamation, whether it would be the appointed date or it would be the effective date. Because as per the law, the amalgamation is deemed to have taken place from the appointed date, and every transaction which takes place post the appointed date is treated as done for and on behalf of the amalgamated entity. So one view could be applying the Supreme Court judgment in Marshall Sons that the date of amalgamation should be the date of the appointed date. However, the another view could be that the fusion or the actual merger takes place as on the effective date, even though the effect is given retrospectively with effect from the appointed date. So the position as on the effective date is to be considered, but there is no clarity in the existing law as to which date is to be taken. And the second connected issue is to how far back you will go. So for example, the merger takes place say in 2018 and you distribute a dividend say in 2028. So whether you will have to take the position as on the reserves existing as on the date of amalgamation, which is 2018, and consider it in 2028. So these are few issues actually which are not clear from the fine print.
I think I will further complicate to what Rohit has said. This amendment is applicable for the current assessment year, which is ongoing. So this is applicable for assessment year 18-19, which is running. That's one. The second is, Rohit gave an example of merger happening, let us say after this amendment comes into force in 2018, and then you are looking at a reduction of capital in 2028. Clearly, in my view, this law will apply if it continues to see the light in 2028. But assume that the merger happened in 2004 and the reduction is happening today. Now the trigger event is the distribution to the shareholders on reduction today when this law applies. So will you look into the accumulated profits of the amalgamating company in 2004 to now tax it as deemed dividend? This will amount to giving it a retroactive operation. So I think these are issues that will need to be debated, and I think clearly one will be arguing against the retroactive operation of this section. That transactions which have already been consummated before this final bill becomes law, they certainly cannot be hit by this kind of an amendment. But these are open questions.
In fact, another example which came to us was, the scheme was still to be passed by the court, and the appointed date which is still pending in the court is, say for example, 1-4-2018 and the scheme 1-4-2017, and the schemes actually is passed subsequently, say in May 2018. So whether in that situation I still have to take the position as on the date when it is effective, or as on the date it is appointed, and whether or not the law would apply to that kind of a situation. So there are many complications which are going to arise.
And you know, whether this was really required, you know, once the GAR has triggered in, this could have been taken care of by GAR also.
Actually, GAR would have taken care of this. Okay. In fact, we have given another illustration to just explain this issue. For example, just take another example where the reserves in the hands of the amalgamating company is 9000 rupees. There is no security premium in that company. But you have another company where you have the security premium of 4000 rupees. And in the amalgamating company, you have the cash available. And as per the accounting standards, you can follow the purchase method whereby you revalue the assets and bring it to the fair market value. Now, following the fair market value method, amalgamating company is merged with this amalgamated company. In that situation, in the identity of the reserves is lost, because accounting standard says that in case of scheme of amalgamation by purchase method, the identity of the reserves cannot be kept intact. They ceases to exist. So in that situation, what will happen is, in that kind of an amalgamation, this 9,000 rupees of revenue reserves, this identity is lost in the process of merger. And what will remain in the hands of consolidated entity would be security premium of 16,500. So if this company, after the merger, were to distribute the assets, in that situation, under the existing law, the deemed dividend provisions would not apply, because there is no revenue reserves. Because the courts and some of the judgments had held that any reserve which is created in the course of amalgamation, that cannot be regarded as revenue reserve. And that identity of 9,000 reserves is lost during the course of amalgamation. So in that situation, after the merger taking place, there is no deemed dividend. But with the new amended provisions, what would happen is, in this case, nil would be increased by 9,000, which is the revenue reserves of the amalgamating entity, and therefore this will become 9,000 in the hands of the consolidated entity. So to the extent of 9,000, the deemed dividend provisions would apply in the hands of the consolidated entity. So this is how the amended provisions are going to be applied in case of as proposed in the finance bill. So this is what we have explained.
Question here, would a situation change if a loss company gets merged with a profit company?
No, that would not be required. Because if you were to, that in the existing provision also, why would you merge a loss company into a profit company to escape the taxation of deemed dividend?
No. His point is, see, if a loss company merges into a profit company, your accumulated profit will come down if you take the aggregate of the two.
But
so whether in that situation, his point is, whether
but technically in that speaking, it's the law says the profits of the amalgamating company are to be increased. So in your situation, it is already depressed. So they don't need to increase it.
So in that situation, your accumulated profits will be limited to the aggregate of the two. That's the point.
Aggregate, and in that situation, in any case, deemed dividend would apply.
So therefore, it is not that you ignore the loss of the amalgamating company. I think that's the question. What will be the quantum of accumulated profit? Whether
it will be after merger.
Right.
So basically, what will happen is, supposedly taking your example, in this example, the reverse situation was there. 10,000 was the reserves of the amalgamating company and 9,000 was the profits of the amalgamated company. So there will be minus 1,000. The law says that minus 1,000 would be increased by the profits of the amalgamating company. So it says there were no profits in the amalgamating company, nothing is to be increased. So in any case, this is minus 1,000. In any case, if the amalgamated company prior to the amalgamation were to distribute, then also there was no deemed dividend. Because
there is no hierarchy in amalgamation.
There is no hierarchy.
It doesn't matter. In this case, the one is profitable, other
is not. So normally what is happens is, so for example, there is two companies, company A and company B. The scheme specifically normally says company A is getting merged into B or B is into getting merged. Because otherwise, if you say both the companies merged, either you will have to specify what would be the name of the new company, or you will have to adopt the name of one of the companies. Normally the schemes would provide, because you are right, there is a fusion between the two companies. So the identity of both are lost, both becomes one. But this will have, because otherwise name change will have to take place. So this is how the provisions are. Moving on, because considering the limited time, there are a few, one or two more things which are to be covered. In exemption, I just want to highlight one aspect, which is with regard to this employment generation incentives under section 80JJAA. One of the important amendment which has taken place, under the existing provisions, what happens is that if any SSE which is subjected to tax audit, they hire new people, an additional employee cost is paid for employment of new employees for employment of new workers, then the additional wages or the additional remuneration which you pay is allowed as deduction at the rate of 30% over a period of 3 years. This is subject to the condition that the employee should have been employed in the year of employment for a period of 240 days. In certain category of industry, it is reduced to 150 days. So you have to take the number of days of employment in the year in which the person is employed. The amendment which is proposed by the finance bill is, supposingly in the year of employment, say year one, the employee, the person works with you for 100 days, but in the next day, he is for more than 240 days in the next year too. In that situation, in the existing provision, you don't get any deduction under section 80JJAA. But under the proposed amendment, the person will be deemed to be employed in year 2 and you will accordingly get deduction from year 2 onwards. So, existing provision says that the person must be employed and must be there for more than 240 days or 150 days as the case may be. So, unless he completes 240 days or 150 days in the year of employment, you do not get any deduction. So even if the person is for 100 days in first year and next year he is for the entire year 365 days, you don't get any deduction under the existing provisions. The amendment which is proposed is that if he is for 100 days in first year, so he does not cross the threshold of 240 days, but in the next year he crosses the threshold of 240 days, he will be deemed to be employed in year 2. And then you can get benefit of 30% in from year 2 onwards. So, you can get benefit in year 2, year 3 and year 4. So, that's an important amendment which has been done in section 80JJAA.
Salary paid in the first year, what will happen to that? Will it be weighted?
Normal deduction is allowed. 80JJAA would not be allowed.
That is right. Right, but the employment condition is completed in the second year.
Correct.
The second year I will be getting the benefit of 80JJAA.
Correct.
But the salary was paid eligible for the 80JJAA for the first year also. So will it be brought from the first year for the weighted average?
No, as the law says is it will be deemed to be employed in year 2. So when you give effect to the fiction, you will consider the salary which is paid in year 2. And see, that 30% would be allowed.
Yeah, see, basically, in your example, he was not a qualifying employee under the existing provision. So, once he did not cross the threshold of 240 days in year 1, you did not get deduction for the 3 years because he was not a qualifying employee. Now, he is employed in year 1 for 100 days as per Rohit's example. Next year, 240, he becomes a qualifying employee in year 2. And you get the benefit for the 3 years starting with year 2. For the salary paid in those respective years, I think your question.
In fact, you get a higher deduction because in year 2 you will consider the entire for entire 240 days.
Right.
Had you considered it for year 1, it would have been a lower amount.
So, in the years when this additional exemption will be claimed, is it necessary that employee should be there in the employment?
Yes, sir. Year 2.
Year 2 he has to be there.
No, the qualifying employee, he does not be a qualifying employee in year 1 if he does not cross the threshold of 240.
Hmm.
Under existing provision, the benefit would not be available at all, even if he is to continue in employment in year 2. That was the existing provision. Under the amended provision which are proposed, if he does not cross the threshold in year 1, but makes the mark in year 2, he is employed for more than 240 days, then in that situation, he will be a qualifying employee from year 2. Earlier, the benefit was being lost. Now, the benefit will be available, but from year 2.
So this gives you the benefit which is not available under the existing regime.
Can you have the mic there, Durgesh? Yes. Last.
Yeah, there are some salary conditions also there, ki up to 25,000.
That conditions remain the same.
And my question is there, in subsequent year, if salary increase, the benefit is for the next 3 years, right? So whether the benefit will be given for subsequent year or not?
Prima facie, it would be lost because you do not qualify all the conditions. The amendment proposed is you will be deemed to be person employed in that year.
Right.
So you have to satisfy all those conditions in that year.
Right.
So deeming fiction has to be taken to its logical conclusion. So in that situation, since while you qualify this threshold of 240 days, but you still are not an eligible employee because you cross the threshold of the quantum of the salary.
That means I will get in first year, but in second year salary increase, then I will not.
No, first year also you don't get.
No, my salary is below 25,000 first year.
But you don't cross the threshold of 240 days.
No, I have. My query is basically I've, on number of days I have crossed the threshold, right?
You are saying that under the existing law,
I crossed the threshold limit, right? The number of days. Now my question is on second part and the salary part. There is some limit is fixed in 80 GJA.
So year one you qualify both the conditions.
Both the conditions. Now second year what happened? My due to increment the salary increases to that employee.
I think
we have taken the position, it is allowed.
I think it will be allowed, yeah. Our position is it is allowable. Because year one you qualify and then you get a vested right to claim it for 3 years.
3 years. So that means I will be able to eligible for higher amount in subsequent year because my salary will increase to that extent.
But do we change the amount?
I think no. His point is
no, but
is
we don't take the amount. We only take the 30% in 3 years. We don't change the amount. 80 AA.
30% of the salary amount.
Salary amount in the year one has to be considered for the purpose of deduction.
Okay, you are saying
so that is not changing.
Okay.
You don't consider the according to me you don't consider the next year's 30% on the new amount. Year one, you have to take the year one salary for the purpose of deduction.
Okay.
You see, recently the Supreme Court came with a decision in the case of multi-axle on the question whether a small scale undertaking is to be given a benefit for a period of 10 years under 80IC or 80IB. Now the question was in the first year, the investment in plant and machinery was below the threshold. Next year it crossed the threshold. The High Court had held that once you qualify as a small scale undertaking in the first year in the year of formation, you must get the benefit for 10 years. Okay. The Supreme Court said this is a precondition that you must be a small scale undertaking. So that condition has to be seen every year. And they therefore denied the benefit for the years in which you crossed the threshold of the investment in plant and machinery. But for 80JJAA, this is not a condition precedent that your salary must be below 25,000 in each of the 3 years. It must be below 25,000 in the year of employment.
Okay.
So once you satisfy that, as Rohit said, you get a vested right to get deduction over for 3 years of the salary paid in the base year.
Rohit, just to understand,
okay.
In the year next 3 years, when this exemption will be claimed, is it at all necessary for the employee to be remain there in the employment or is it not?
So you are saying that year one you qualify all the conditions, but year two he leaves.
No, year two is there.
No, he is not there.
No, year one, okay, you are taking year two as year one, all right, okay.
In year one, he qualifies 240 days and he leaves.
So you are saying that he qualifies and then leaves.
And next year on 1st April.
There is no specific condition that he should continue in employment in all the 3 years.
So suppose one employee is there, he is employed for 365 days in year one.
No.
31st March, he resigns and on 1st April, he is reappointed next year.
नहीं नहीं बट इसमें जो एडिशनल एम्प्लॉय कॉस्ट तो वैसे निकालना पड़ेगा दैट एडिशनल चेंज होगा नो इफ दिस एडिशनल एम्प्लॉय कॉस्ट विल बी अ मैथमेटिकल कैलकुलेशन इफ दैट मैन इज नॉट देयर देन आई थिंक दैट विल टेक अवे फ्रॉम एडिशनल एम्प्लॉय कॉस्ट बट वी विल आंसर दिस क्वेश्चन
बिकॉज अदरवाइज इट कैन लीड टू मल्टीपल डिडक्शंस एवरी ईयर मींस एम्प्लॉयर कैन प्लान दिस वे ऑन फर्स्ट अप्रैल इज अपॉइंटेड 31st मार्च
चलो वील कम बैक यू ओके चलो आगे चलो वील जस्ट चेक दिस आउट एंड कम बैक
विद रिगार्ड टू दी स्टार्टअप सर्टेन फ्यू टू अमेंडमेंट विच हैव बीन डन इज वन इज दिस द चेंज इन द पीरियड ऑफ द स्टार्ट ऑफ द बिजनेस हैज बीन डन एंड द टर्नओवर कंडीशन हैज बीन चेंज्ड दिस Other is with regard to the ATP benefit being given to the farm producer companies which is engaged in these businesses, basically marketing of agriculture produce, purchase of agriculture produce and implements, etc. Then one major amendment is with regard to the exemption to non-employee subscriber. Presently, if you see the provisions of 1012A, the employee who has contributed to NPS and he withdraws the amount, then 40% is allowed. Though for that purpose, he has to be employee at the time of withdrawal. Now the condition is to be proposed to be relaxed by saying that whether or not at the time of withdrawal, whether he is employee or not, the benefit would be there. Now, one major amendment is with regard to this exemption of transfer between parent and subsidiary. Now, 47 specifically exempts a transaction between a parent and a subsidiary. But if you see, there is a corresponding section 56, which says that if the recipient receives any immovable or removable asset without consideration or for inadequate consideration, then that is deemed as income in the hands of the recipient. So, there was no corresponding amendment in section 56, while the transaction between a holding and a subsidiary company was exempt from tax. So, this is what is sought to be clarified by a specific amendment in section 56 to provide that any transaction between a holding and a subsidiary company that will not be subjected to tax under section 56. So, it is excluded from the list of the transactions. Now, this amendment, I think, there is some confusion among some sections. Under the existing regime, there is a specific section 80AC which says that if you don't file your return of income within time, then in that situation certain deductions are not allowed to you, under which are prescribed under section chapter 6A. Now, the amendment which is proposed is that the filing of return within time has been made mandatory in order to claim all deductions which falls under chapter heading C of chapter 6A. Now, if you see chapter heading C starts with deduction under section 80HH onwards. So, there is some confusion that 80C also is lost by an individual if the return is not filed in time, which is not the case. 80C is not covered by 80AC. You will still continue to get the benefit of 80C, 80L, 80TTA, etc. The amendment which is proposed is only with regard to the deductions which are starting from 80HH onwards.
Profit-based incentives.
Which are basically profit-based incentives normally available to companies, etc. So, that will get covered. But 80C will be there. Correct. Not under C. So, that is also under part CA, 80TTA.
Yes. With part CA. So, I think what is important is that this amendment or even the existing provision of 80AC is extremely high-handed and arbitrary, that if for any reason you are not able to file a return in time, your deduction is lost for that particular year. We had challenged the constitutional validity of this provision. Unfortunately, we lost in the High Court, and the High Court held that the provision is constitutionally valid, the legislature is competent to make any provision. But there have been court decisions which have said that in a situation where your return is delayed, you should approach the Central Board of Direct Taxes under section 119 to seek a relaxation for the delayed filing of return. So, this is just for information.
Now, few miscellaneous amendments which are proposed in the finance bill is, one is with regard to the charitable organization. Presently, the provisions relating to section 40AIA, which is regarding the non-deduction of tax at source and the disallowance of expense, and the cash payments under section 40A3, etc., are not applicable to charitable institutions, because the settled law is that charitable institutions are not governed by the normal chapter 4, etc., which is PGBP, etc., and therefore these provisions of section 40AI, 40A3 are not applicable to charitable institution. Now, in order to regulate this, in order to have a less cash economy, the proposed amendment in the finance bill is that even 40AIA and 40A3 would apply to charitable institution. So, in case of a charitable institution, if they were to default in deducting TDS under section under any of the provisions of the Act, then that amount will not be regarded as application of income, and that would not be eligible for exemption under section 11 and 12. And similarly the case for section 1023C also, which talks of charitable trust and institution. It may not have. In that situation, it may not have. Yeah. But it may not have.
It may not have. It will only go to add to the income. Your spending requirement will, the 85% will increase to that extent.
I think in this speech, the FM was trying to convey the intent that tax has to be paid on this amount.
No, it says it will not be treated as
application of income. The law says, as proposed in the fine print, is that any amount on which you don't deduct TDS, there is a default and 40AI applies, in that situation it will not be treated as application of income. So if you have spent 90% and the this is within the 5% bracket, so probably there will not be any issue. Now the next amendment is only with regard to immovable properties. So for example, today the if you transfer an immovable property and the consideration which you actually receive is less than the stamp value, the value which is considered for the purpose of payment of stamp duty, then the difference is also taxed as, and the consider the amount, the fair value as on, as per the stamp value is to be considered, and there is no margin which is provided for the difference between the actual consideration and the stamp value consideration. Now what is the finance bill proposed to insert a new provision to provide that up to 5% of difference will not be considered for the purpose of taxation under section 43CA and 56 as well as 50C. So this is a very marginal relief as such of 5%.
They like a safe harbor.
It's like a safe harbor. The one amendment in bad provisions is today in case of a foreign company which is governed by there is a specific explanation 4 which says that in case of foreign companies being residents of countries with which India has DTA and not having permanent establishment is outside the purview of MAT. That was the amendment which was made pursuant to various representation, but there was no specific provision exempting MAT in case of companies which are subjected to tax under presumptive basis like 44B, 44BB. For example, you provide a rig that may constitute a PE, and in that situation you may be subjected to tax, and they are paying tax on a presumptive basis. So they were also technically falling under the MAT provision. So the amendment which is proposed is retrospective in nature to clarify that MAT provisions would not apply to all these companies which are paying tax under presumptive regime. One amendment under the PAN provisions is that PAN is now being made mandatory for every entity other than an individual who enters into a transactions of more than 2.5 lakhs. So that entity has to take the PAN as well as its managing director, manager, etc. They will also have to take PAN, that is made mandatory. Then the commodity transaction tax, there are certain amendments. This we have considered, and failure to furnish return, presently if you fail to furnish the return that can lead to prosecution, but prosecution is not there if the tax payment, the TDS default is not exceeding 3000 rupees. Now there are certain companies which may not be which may be less than even 3000 rupees, which may be holding assets. So the proposed amendment is that in case of certain companies, even this threshold of 3000 would not apply, and they can still be subjected to prosecution if they have nil income. Then the penalty for failure to furnish certain financial transactions report has been proposed to be increased from 100 rupees to 500 rupees per day. And there are certain amendments relating to advance rulings. These are some miscellaneous amendments, and with this we come to the end of this our clause by clause analysis.
Friends, before we conclude this session, we shall be failing in our duty if we do not acknowledge our appreciation and gratitude for the direct tax, our friends at in the direct tax team who have worked, burned the midnight oil and worked tirelessly prepare for this session.
We also acknowledge the efforts put in by Mr. Kannan Nath, who has looked after the administration very efficiently, and Rakesh ji, who was providing the all the IT support. So with this we come to end of this session. Thanks for joining us, and you may join us for the lunch.
Thank you for your continued patronage. In fact, we were apprehensive because the amendments were not very large. There were few amendments only. So whether there will be appropriate representation, but we are highly thankful to you from the bottom of our heart. Thank you so much.